we'll get to our last speakers in this session. So Brian Graham, environmental engineer operator with 35 years of experience encompassing design, operation of advanced water and wastewater treatment systems, biological nutrient removal, reverse osmosis, water treatment, biosolids management, master planning, wastewater process modeling, and computer simulation. He's been involved in the design, startup, operation of numerous wastewater facilities and projects throughout the United States. For Suez, formerly known as United Water, he was an operator, engineering manager, and process engineer for the 42 MGD West Basin Water Recycling Plant in California. And then Mr. Graham has also served as Suez Senior Director of Operations for the West Division and Director of Technical Assistance for Suez nationwide. And then Ann Conklin is a process engineer with Corolo Engineers with 17 years of experience in facility planning and process modeling. With that, I will turn that over to them.
Yes. Great. There we go. Okay, so we're going to talk today about a streamlined process to help process selection to help utilities meet stringent nitrogen limits. I'm going to start by talking about a background of the Puget Sound Nutrient General Permit, which is requiring utilities in the Puget Sound region to start thinking about nutrients for the first time. A history, we'll proceed then, I'll turn it over to Brian to talk about a history of nutrient removal in Florida, where they've been dealing with nutrient removal for a really, really, really long time. So they know what they're doing here. Kind of some nitrogen removal basics, and then an alternative screening process that Brian has kind of worked through with the utilities in Florida that's really helped them select a process to meet stringent nitrogen. In 2022, the Puget Sound Nutrient General Permit was issued with the goal of controlling the total inorganic nitrogen load to Puget Sound to existing levels. To do this, the permit established action levels for each of the dischargers to the Puget Sound region, which essentially capped their effluent nitrogen load at current levels. In addition to these action levels, the Nutrient General Permit requires that each utility select an optimization strategy to keep their effluent nitrogen below the action level. There's annual reporting requirements. And what's important and relevant to this talk is each utility is also required to do a nutrient reduction evaluation, which is evaluating technologies for the utilities to get to concentrations as low as 3 mg/L, which is a stark difference for a lot of these utilities that have not been nitrifying at all. At this point, I want to turn it over to Brian, where Florida's been dealing with nitrogen limits as low as 3 mg/L for a very long time.
Thanks. So, you know, the first question, why is this old fat guy from Florida up here in beautiful Pacific Northwest talking to you about nutrients? Well, we've been dealing with low nitrogen limits for a very long time, and I'll talk a little bit about that history and how things have evolved in Florida. Just kind of a broad timeline of some of the big events in the United States, and I've highlighted the ones that really affected Florida. And the first one to kind of point out is that 1972, the Wilson-Grizzle Act, and that really was the start of nutrient removal in Florida. It really limited nitrogen discharges to the Tampa Bay area. And then about a decade later, those limits were strengthened, made more stringent, and that Grizzle-Fig statute really set the stage for Florida for the next 30, 40 years. And we'll talk a little bit about each of these kind of milestones in nutrient removal requirements in Florida and kind of what that meant to us. So first, advanced waste, well, everyone says wastewater, but the legislation actually says waste. So advanced waste treatment. And what is that? So it is now a Florida statute. It's not a rule or a regulation. It is law. And it defines advanced waste treatment. And that is BOD, actually state uses CBOD. So BOD is 5 milligrams per liter, suspended solids 5, total nitrogen expressed as N as 3, total phosphorus expressed as 1, and it requires some high level disinfection. These are annual average limits. And what did that really mean? Well, it started in Tampa Bay, and if you're not familiar with Florida, that's Tampa Bay. It started there, and then it kind of spread along the estuaries, along the West Coast, and some of the more impacted water bodies, you know, across the state. And you can see there are quite a number of facilities, and we stopped counting 2016, but there, you know, probably over 100 now, where we're meeting very low limits on a regular basis. And it used to be considered kind of difficult, but now it's almost the de facto standard in Florida. This is what treatment is. So the next big thing that came along was the ocean outfall legislation. And it really was targeted in Southeast Florida. That was really where we were, you know, being forced to increase treatment there. And what it did was it, you know, kind of prohibited more outfall into the ocean. It mandated nutrient reduction, mandated reuse, prohibited discharge after 2025. We'll see if we get there. This is, you know, you're dealing with Miami. They make their own rules sometimes. And it, as I said, it really focuses in the lower southeast part of Florida. And what's kind of important to recognize is that it focused on really 6 outfalls that were impacted. And not all of these outfalls, you know, cover all of that population in the Southeast Florida, but that population just in those 3 counties represents about half the total population of the state of Florida. So that's about 10 million people. And it's all being impacted down there. And this is a big deal. We're still kind of dealing with this. The state's still trying to get, you know, some of these outfalls to kind of plain ice, if you will. But it's moving forward. And again, nutrient reduction was part of that. Oh, I'm hitting the wrong button, sorry. Then the next thing that came along was the numeric nutrient criteria. And this was really predicated from EPA. They basically said that Florida did have to abide by these rules. And it really looked at the state's water bodies and where they were impacted and if they needed to comply with it. And you can see just the water bodies highlighted in red here have to deal with this. So it's quite a bit of area that Florida now is being faced with. And so you have TMDLs and specific water bodies and then water quality based effluent limits are all being impacted on these areas that are shown in red. And then also in the stressor response was another limit on. The latest impact is something we call the springs protection. And it really was focused, this now is taking the nutrient limits more to the center and north part of the state where these beautiful springs are located. And what was happening, what we're finding is that these nutrients were over time kind of migrating through the groundwater and showing up in the springs would get these terrible algae blooms. So the state doing the right thing is trying to protect these beautiful springs because they have high economic value. A lot of people come to Florida just to, you know, hike and see these springs. They're really lovely. But no one wants to go there when they're all covered with green algae. So these are being kind of protected through a different organization in the state. Instead of the Florida Department of Environmental Protection, we have the water management districts, and they have the ability to draw these basin management action plans. And so through these BMAPs, they're limiting nutrient discharges from the treatment plants. And, you know, we don't like to talk about this because it's really expensive to deal with, but septic tanks are really a big problem too, but they're fighting that at a different battle. So that's kind of the history of some big legislation that's been moving Florida to really low nitrogen limits. You know, typically, as I said, the AWT limit for nitrogen is 3, and that's total nitrogen. So we'll just do a little, you know, kind of primer on nitrogen removal, just so that we're all, you know, kind of on the same page. So when we deal with total nitrogen in Florida, we have to look at, you know, the particulate nitrogen that's leaving, you know, the nitrogen that's in the TSS, any refractory soluble organic nitrogen that is just not being dealt with in the treatment plant. And then of course the usual suspects, ammonia and nitrite nitrate, right? So those are, we've got to deal with all of that. And, you know, particulate, we deal with filters that kind of handles that. Ammonia and nitrate, you know, we'll talk about that. That's kind of the bread and butter, but it's that soluble organic nitrogen that we have to really be careful with. Typically it's low, you know, half a part, but when you got a limit of 3, a half a part is a, you know, kind of a big chunk of it. The difference then with TIN, which I understand the Puget Sound to be dealing with, it's really, we're focusing just on the ammonia and nitrite nitrate. So that helps quite a bit, right? We can focus on the things that we can really impact. And just to set the stage, the classic, you know, nitrogen cycle, we're not gonna talk about anammox here and those reactions. But, you know, typically, you know, what comes into the plant are these, and we want to get it the nitrogen gas, and we kind of have to run the gamut, you know, to get it to nitrate and then back through denitrification to nitrogen. So that's what we're going to talk about real quickly here. So it's really, you know, nutrient removal is 2 reactions: nitrogen removal, nitrification, where we convert that ammonia to nitrite and then nitrate, and then denitrification, where we take that nitrate and then convert it to nitrogen. So nitrification, kind of the basic, you know, textbook reaction, but what do we really mean here? We need some oxygen. That's aerobic conditions, so we have to drive that reaction. And in the old days, we only knew of 2 bacteria when I was in school, but now we call them AOBs and NOBs to get the whole broad families. And we have to provide enough time for them to grow. So that's really the difference there, is that we have a lot of oxygen demand and we have to hold those bacteria long enough so that they can grow. And then we have to control that pH because, as we'll see, they consume alkalinity as part of their reaction, right? We see it there with the hydrogen that's released, right? So what are the physical effects? So we have increase in demand of oxygen. That obviously increases power requirements. Our sludge yield might decrease a little bit because we've got a longer SRT, so that might be a benefit. We do have alkalinity depletion. That's something that we're going to have to deal with, especially up here. I've worked in the Pacific Northwest. Nice soft waters, low alkalinity. That can be a real problem. And then we have to have a larger biomass inventory. So, you know, compared to a non-nitrifying plant, we need bigger aeration basins, or bigger clarifiers, or both, right? We can't kind of do it all in the same box. So, you know, the aerobic process, as the previous speaker mentioned, you know, above 2 parts DO, we don't really see a huge increase in the nitrification rate, but we do need oxygen to drive that. So nitrification rate increases with DO, but above 2, not so much. Solids retention time, we need to maintain a minimum aerobic SRT, right? That keeps the nitrifiers in the system. Where do we do that? That's in the aerobic basins, right? So we'll have anoxic basins, we might have anaerobic basins, but we're really focused on that aerobic SRT. So we only use that aerobic volume in that calculation. Nitrification is sort of an all or nothing kind of reaction, right? I mean, we can control it to some extent. We can hinder nitrification. it gets pretty complex to do that. It can be done, but we like to just, for simplicity, think of it as an all or nothing. So if we have a very low SRT, we'll get no growth, but we'll get no nitrification. And then as we start to get some growth, right, it falls off very quickly. Ammonia starts to fall off. And then after we kind of reach that stable point again, then it's kind of complete, right? We're getting really solid nitrification. So this partial zone is a real kind of gray zone to live in. We don't want to be in there. So we basically say either go all the way or don't. Like I said, you can do it in the middle, but boy, it gets tricky. And then this is just to show that temperature has an impact, as the previous speaker mentioned, right? Colder temperatures require longer aerobic SRT to maintain that biogrowth. Alkalinity requirements, because we're releasing the hydrogen ion as part of the reaction, that chews up alkalinity. So we've got to watch that, because as the pH drops, we can hinder nitrification. We like to maintain about 80 milligrams per liter. You know, that's not a hard and fast number, but you need enough there to maintain the pH stability and act as a buffer. And then how do we recover alkalinity? Well, we can just add some chemical. That works, but we can also denitrify as denitrification returns some alkalinity. So some ways that we can configure the basins, right? So maybe we add on to conventional, right? We have a conventional plant. We end up with a lot of ammonia leaving. We have some downstream nitrification process. We can build a two-stage system where we nitrify, we remove carbon, BOD in the first, and then we nitrify in the second. This is still going on. There's still some large plants that do this. The most prominent probably is the Howard Kern plant in Tampa. It's a 90 MGD plant. It was designed in the early 70s. It still operates in this mode. And then there's what is more common and what is very likely, the first choice today is a kind of a single sludge nitrification. Things like attached growth, like BAFs, can be used kind of downstream if we just need to nitrify. They're very effective, very efficient, small footprint, very robust. They do a pretty good job. Let's talk about denitrification quickly. Again, what we're trying to do is remove that nitrate that converted to nitrogen gas. So we need a carbon source. That can be a few things. But most importantly, we need no oxygen. We need an environment where there's only nitrate and no free oxygen for the bacteria. We force them to use that. That's called anoxic conditions. We need some readily available carbon. It's not complex. BOD, it's kind of the candy bars, right? The stuff that's easily digested, so readily degradable BOD. And again, some of the effects, it consumes carbon, that's good, right? If we're using BOD as a source, but it's not good if we're using a supplemental carbon, then we got to pay for it. It does provide some oxygen recovery if we configure it properly, because if we do it in such a way that we're using up BOD to get that carbon source, then that's BOD we don't have to otherwise oxidize. It does produce some alkalinity, that's good. It does produce sludge. We can't, ignore that it still is growing bacteria. So there is biogrowth and it produces sludge. And because we need a reactor, we need another box. So we need a bigger reactor. So how do we do that? Well, first we have to provide that sufficient volume, and it's the green box. We have to prevent air from getting in there, right? So if we're mixing, we can't be so aggressive in our mixing that we're actually stirring and bringing air in. DO and the mixed liquor recycle, right? We got to make sure that we're not returning a bunch of DO, because that defeats the purpose. And overmixing, as I said, can cause it. And then the second requirement, we have to get the nitrate back to that zone, right? So how do we do that? We use mixed liquor return pumps. They have to be big enough. We have to match them to the size of the volume, right? So we don't bring back more than the volume can handle. And then we provide enough volume to handle what we're bringing back, if you will. And then the carbon source, right? The efficiency of that denitrification will be affected by the type of carbon that we're using and the concentration of the carbon. So, you know, that BOD to TKN ratio, just some rules of thumb. They're not hard and fast numbers, but, you know, we really want a nice high BOD to TKN ratio to really drive that if we're using BOD as our carbon source. And it can be BOD, methanol, acetic acid, glycerin. There's lots of sources. And the selection of that supplemental carbon source should be very carefully considered. And side note, Florida, there was a terrible accident with methanol. Two operators were killed. So methanol is not the first choice in Florida for carbon source anymore. So low effluent total inorganic nitrogen might require multiple zones, as was presented before, like a four-stage Bardenfoe plant. We can't really get to very low numbers with just a single anoxic zone. We can accomplish this using attached growth also, right? We could add D-nite filters. They work just fine. And then, you know, the provisions for supplemental carbon, it's very likely that if you're driving to really low numbers, it's not a bad idea to have a provision to add that. I'm not suggesting that you have to build it right in and, you know, stockpile it, but when you need it. And it wouldn't be a bad idea to have a way to get it in there effectively. Okay, so that's the intro part of this, and I hope you're still awake. We'll talk a little bit about why I'm really here, what we've been doing with some of our clients in Florida to help them get through all the options to provide a defensible document to say, this is how we ended up with the solution that we did, right? So very basically, the goal of this screening process is to provide the utility with a defendable document to protect against scrutiny, second guessing, and unfounded process technologies, right? We've been burned, our clients have been burned by saying, hey, we know what the best options are. Let's pick the three likely suspects. Let's narrow it down to one and go forward. And then the next thing you know, some vendor comes out of nowhere and says, hey, you didn't look at my special new technology and it's the best thing ever and it'll save you more money and everything's wonderful. And then the train comes off the track and you got to go back in time and redo all this and find out that no, it really doesn't exist. It's just kind of a made up thing. So what we're trying to do here is say, look, we've looked at every alternative that's available today and we're going to screen that down in a methodical manner so that we can provide you with a defendable selection, right? A couple of things, the reliability and redundancy are included in all the alternatives. So we don't want people saying, well, this option's more reliable than that option. The reliability is built into the design. It's not part of a technology per se, it's part of the design to include that reliability and redundancy. And very importantly, costs are not part of this initial screening. At this level, we are at such a high level that any cost estimate we do, they would essentially be equal or at least all within the margin of error of the other. So it really is there's no value in doing cost estimates at this high level. So we want to, you know, for every plant that we're looking at with the client, sometimes it's multiple plants, sometimes it's one big plant. We want to look at kind of the universe of options. Like what is out there that we could look at? We'll group these technologies by family, right? So that we don't have to look at every single, you know, minor modification of a technology. We'll screen that down to look at the best suited alternatives to meet the treatment goals, right? I mean, if you have nitrogen and phosphorus, that's one thing. If you just have nitrogen or if you just have phosphorus, we have to look at the technologies that are suitable for whatever is the treatment goals. Where we really get into it in a more methodical way is we apply structured decision analysis, right? So that's where we take the utility's values, not the engineer's, not my decision. It's the utility's values and apply that to some very basic quantitative criteria to end up with the right solution for the utility. And then from there, we can take a narrowed down one or two alternative, maybe three, and prepare real detailed conceptual designs and costs where we can really have some input on, is this technology, will it be cheaper than that technology? So how do we do that? So here's, we've done this three times in the past year and a half or so for three different clients, and it all followed the basic same path. Ended up with different solutions, as you might expect, because they're different utilities. But this was our universe of technologies that we started with. There's quite a number of options there. And we said, well, the first thing we have to do is let's get rid of the technologies that absolutely cannot meet the objective. And by just doing that, we got rid of a lot of options why bother? Why bother looking at, right? From there, we took what was left, right? So we had a few technologies left and we grouped them into the families. And we said, well, let's pick one from each family and carry that forward into the structured, you know, decision analysis. And if for example, one of these comes out where it has other members of the family that we should look at, we can broaden that at that time. But if it doesn't make sense, there's no sense carrying all that forward, right? Again, it's their nuances in the families. So how do we do this? This is kind of the meat of the matter here. So it's really a two-path solution. On the one path, we screen these treatment technologies, right? And we score them with an independent panel on quantitative criteria, things that we can measure, or at least measure to some degree. The owner takes their values and we'll give them a set of values. We'll work with them on what is important to them. And they'll take those values and then they'll weight those and we'll take those weightings from the owner and we'll apply them to the criteria from the expert. So structured decision, what were the primary evaluation criteria? This is what the owner is kind of using as their values, right? And what you see on the left side are the primary, the big headings, and then the sub criteria under it. You may not be able to read it, but it just breaks down what that criteria is. And we take time to educate the owner utility on what is an established technology. What does that mean? What is treatment effectiveness, right? We're not going to pick something that doesn't work, but what is that? How robust is it? How tried and true? The operability, construction sequencing, footprint, things like that are important to the owner that has these limitations. And what we're trying to do is have them weigh in on what is more important to me. Is it the footprint? Do I got to go buy a bunch of land to make this work? Or I don't care. I'll pay what it takes. I want an established technology. That's not my decision. That's the owner's. That's their values. So you can't read this, of course. But what this is was the expert scoring, and it was much longer, but it wasn't one or two. It was probably a dozen senior independent engineers that scored each of these technologies on their abilities to meet each of those criteria that we laid out, right? So we ended up with a consensus there. And this is kind of a summary. It's like the executive summary, if you will, of what that looked like for this, this one evaluation, right? So, you know, it was scored 1 to 5, but just for the executive summary, if you will, you know, we were looking at, you know, is it an established technology? Can it meet the criteria? You know, some of them, we weren't so sure, right? We don't have any track record in the United States at the time. We didn't know. Operability. Operability is an interesting one. It doesn't just mean how easy is it to operate. Is it different from what you have now? Will your operators need to be trained differently? Is there something about it that's just not conventional in a way? Is there a peer group that they can contact and say, hey, I'm having a problem. Hey, you run this plant. What do you know? Right? When the only other plant is in, you know, Amsterdam. You know, what do you tell the operator? How good's your Dutch? You know, give them a call. I don't know. So those were some of the things that we were trying to, you know, identify from just a purely quantitative basis. But what's important is this structured decision analysis, because this is where the owner's values are really, we force them to kind of come to terms with that. Oh, I didn't know that built, sorry. So what we do with a pairwise comparison or structured decision is we force the person that's reviewing that, or the group, whether it's we're breaking the teams into operations, engineering, management, executive team, or, you know, Bob and Sue and Todd and Laura, right? To say, what is more important to you? You have to choose between each of these. And what we effectively do is force them to choose between each criteria, right? So that they rank each one against the other. And it's like picking your favorite child, right? Sometimes you go, man, they're both really important to me. You got to pick one. You can't be, you know, waffling on this. You just got to go with something. So we give them a form and they go and they fill it out. One of these was done during the pandemic, so we couldn't get together. So this was all done virtually, which was a little difficult in its own right, but they fill out their form, they send it back, and we get this, we get a ranking, right? So each of the participants, and this is just one example, we did it with one group, we did it as a whole, it was before the pandemic, we filled the room with the entire utility department, and everyone was broken into teams, and the teams voted, and then those votes were put in, so that we really kind of got everyone's input. This was a representative from each department for this utility, kind of filled that role. And what they did, you can see they each voted what was important to them. And those rankings were then taken, and we ended up getting kind of an average weight for each of those. And you can see, you know, how those ranked out for this one utility. What's interesting to note is that the community acceptability was not very important to anyone. You know, so think about that. And that's what that looks like kind of in a pie chart. So for this utility, it was pretty evenly dispersed, right? It didn't have a real favorite, if you will, or the weight wasn't put in all one value. They kind of spread that. So for this utility, then we rank them. We take that weight and we put it on top of the criteria that we've established and graded out. And you can see here that what was kind of the top three they had predetermined that they would go with was a BNR, kind of a conventional BNR activated sludge, an MBR, and a Nuvoda. Nuvoda is a type of an IFAS that like the previous speaker talked about, right? So those were the three that they decided to carry forward. And that's what the ranking looks like. And what's nice about this is you can kind of see where each of the technologies scored, right? You know, why were they, you know, why was BNR really good, but yet it wasn't so good on footprint. And for this owner, footprint was really important because they had no more land, right? So even though that's what they wanted, it's likely not a viable solution for them. And when we got into the preliminary engineering, it kind of fell out. It was just not possible. So that's really how we do this. You know, the pairwise comparison, that structured decision is done by the owner. We take that input, we develop those conceptual designs and the costs, and then we carry that forward, right? So that what that ends up with though is a document, not a huge document, it's pretty small, you know, 35, 40 pages that says, here's how we did this. You know, we document that. And Greg Rouse in Sarasota County, he told me he uses that document in the last year. Now we're through design already and they're beginning construction, but he used that document probably once a month when people would come to him and go, I don't know, are we doing the right thing? He'd pull out that document and go, we're doing the right thing. We've documented it. We've got the answer, right? Whether it was a board member, whether it was his own staff, whether it was some vendor that came in and said, wait a minute, you didn't look at, yes, we did. We looked at everything and we picked our solution and it's the most appropriate for us. And that's what we're building. So that's really was the goal, was how can we quickly get to a place where we have a document that leads us forward, gives us a clear definition of what are the most appropriate technologies to carry forward into conceptual design and be defensible so that when those second guesses come around, that the owner can say, I've been there, we know we have the right technology selected, and from there, we will pick the right technology for us. So that's basically our presentation, and sorry, I'll take any questions if you have any.
Yeah. Hi, I might have missed this. I'm just wondering, was capital or O&M cost part of the criteria?
So yes and no. So not at first. The initial screening, costs were not considered, because what we've found is that at the very highest level, all the costs ends up being equal within the margin of error of the others. So once this, once we get down to the conceptual design, we carry those forward and do a very detailed, maybe a 30% design. Two of the projects, we were at 30%. We carried those forward and got really detailed costs, both capital and OPEX. And then from there, the decision was made, you know, what is the right one? And cost wasn't always the winner, right? There were times when the lowest cost was not what the owner selected, because there were other important considerations that costs couldn't capture. So yes, costs are considered, but they're considered later in the decision, because we just don't believe that we can do cost estimating well enough at that high level to make it a differentiator.
New question. I saw you had some intensification technologies up there you looked at, and I know it's case by case for each outfit, but are you seeing them, you know, more of them down in Florida, or is it still more of a classic traditional approach?
What we're seeing, the classic IFES has kind of made its way through the market, and it didn't stick, if you will. There was one client in Southeast Florida that designed it, but then put it on the shelf, and I don't know that they'll move forward with it. MBR is very popular, so MBR is getting a lot of traction as intensification, because it does a lot for utilities in Florida. Not only does it allow us to meet low nutrient limits, it provides a really high quality effluent. And some recent legislation is pushing utilities into potable reuse. So that sets them up for that next step, and the legislation's already. So we're seeing a lot of MBR interest. Four of the last five designs that we've done have been MBR, ranging from fairly small to, you know, in Florida, a big plant is 10 MGD because we're not, you know, we don't have big catchment areas where everything flows to a center point. So we're very flat. So you pump a while and then you got a treatment plant. So Sarasota County is a 18 MGD plant. It's that one MBR. That's a fairly large plant in Florida. So we're seeing that. Nuvoda is getting some interest. I think because of some of the concerns with, the plastic media, you know, as it, you know, how do you deal with it? You know, if you got to take a basin down, the etching on the concrete, the beaching has been concerns for some people. Nuvoda seems interesting to them. We haven't seen we're doing a full scale pilot at a fairly large facility that should bring some interest. So we're seeing those types of interests. Narita, not so much at all. It can't. We don't believe that it can actually meet the 3 total nitrogen without some additional add-ons, and that kind of defeats the purpose. So we're not seeing that. I guess I kind of covered the big one. If you have specifics, I'd be glad to share. Look, Florida, if you want the typical, it's a 10 million gallon a day, 5-stage Bard and Faux with tertiary filtration and high level of disinfection. That's kind of like the classic Florida treatment plant these, you know, over the past 40 years. You'll still find, you know, a lot of developer built package plants that, you know, are falling apart and the owners are struggling to figure out what to do with them. But, that 5-stage Bard and Faux has been a workhorse in Florida for, 30 years.
Great. Well, thank you much.
Good. Yeah. It's lunchtime. Perfect. Enjoy.